Then I'll go through some past vulnerabilities in blockchains, and especially on blockchains projects that Qtum uses as the basis of our source code. So I'll go through some fixed vulnerabilities in Bitcoin, in Ethereum, and also in Peercoin, which forms the basis of Blackcoin, which is where we get our proof of stake model. And then I'll go through why it's very important not to have failures or vulnerabilities in blockchains, because they're usually very hard to actually mitigate or fix after you've had a vulnerability being exploited. Then I'll go through some more Qtum specific stuff, like Qtum's testing process, our testing infrastructure, and I'll also go through how the GGP can actually help to upgrade the network in case of any security vulnerability being found. So let's start. So why is security important in blockchains? Well, as most of you probably know, like, there's a lot of value stored in blockchains. So this is a graph of the Bitcoin market cap over time. And as you can see, it's grown a lot. I would have a graph of the Qtum market cap, but Qtum has only existed for such a short period of time that it seemed more relevant to have the Bitcoin market cap instead. And the typical targets of vulnerabilities are either in the core client, that is in, for example, Qtum-D or Bitcoin-D, the like core client, the core executable, that and like vulnerabilities that exploit some fundamental part of the core client or the blockchain itself. And these types of vulnerabilities can be implementation vulnerabilities or implementation bugs, protocol level vulnerabilities, basically vulnerabilities that form some basis in the protocol itself. So they're not actually vulnerabilities in the implementation of the protocol, but they're vulnerabilities in the protocol itself. And then we can have vulnerabilities in smart contracts if the blockchain supports smart contracts. And the types of vulnerabilities that exists in smart contracts are very similar to the types of vulnerabilities that exists in the core blockchain itself. So the type of vulnerabilities that are not relevant for this talk are, for example, vulnerabilities at exchanges, payment processors, or centralized third parties, because they're not directly related to the blockchain itself. So an example of this would be like the Mt. Gox hack, for example, where a lot of coins were stolen. That's not directly related to the blockchain itself, and therefore it's not really relevant for this talk. And most of the vulnerabilities actually occur at these centralized points. So this is a list of thefts and attacks on centralized points, and you can see there are a lot of them, and there are many, many more. And it's usually large amounts of tokens and value that is being stolen from these centralized points. And to be able to actually mitigate these types of bugs and vulnerabilities, it's important to understand previous bugs that have existed in blockchains. So I'll go through some previous bugs and vulnerabilities that have existed in projects that Qtum build upon. And the good thing is that projects that work in this space are often very open and transparent, and post like thorough post-mortems on the vulnerabilities that they've experienced. And they also post very detailed descriptions of fixes that they made and what was the cause of the fundamental issue. So one typical problem, as mentioned earlier, or one typical vulnerability are different types of implementation vulnerabilities. And these can be pretty trivial vulnerabilities. So for example, it can be a simple typo in a code base of thousands and thousands of lines can cause the loss of millions of dollars. And another typical implementation vulnerability would be a missing validation check at some part of the code. And as I said, like, these mistakes are very easy to make, and a simple typo can cause really big losses. So one example of such an implementation bug is the 2010 Bitcoin value overflow incident. So there existed a vulnerability in Bitcoin where an attacker was able to create 184 billion Bitcoins out of thin air. And as some of you may know, the maximum amount of Bitcoins that are ever supposed to exist is 21 million. So that person got very rich very quickly. But the good thing is the issue was quickly fixed, and the corrupted chain that had this transaction that created 184 billion Bitcoins was quickly surpassed. But that was during the early days of Bitcoin, and today it would probably be much, much harder to fix such an issue. And the magnitude would be much, much greater. So here is the fix for the issue. So it's a very small fix, actually. It's just that they check that the value of a transaction output must not exceed the maximum money that can ever exist in Bitcoin. And they check that the sum of all outputs in a transaction may never exceed the max money that can ever exist in Bitcoin, which is, of course, 21 million. And then we have protocol vulnerabilities. And these are usually much harder to test for, because if you have like a fundamental error of logic in the protocol itself, it's very hard to write tests for such an error, because if you're assuming that the protocol works as it's supposed to, then you're testing the software based on the specification you have for the protocol. And it may also be very difficult to deploy a fix if the problem is in the core protocol itself, because you would have to change the core protocol. So one example of such a vulnerability was in Peercoin. And Peercoin was the first proof of stake coin that existed, and it actually is the basis of Blackcoin, which Qtum builds upon. But Peercoin back in 2012 had a protocol level bug that basically an attacker could generate blocks at a faster rate than he or she was supposed to. So an attacker could degenerate the proof of stake model into a proof of work model. And that's very bad. So in proof of stake, you're supposed to generate blocks based on how many coins you hold, basically. While in proof of work, you're supposed to be able to generate blocks at a faster rate depending on how much computational power you have. And if you're able to generate blocks in proof of stake faster based on the computational power you have, then you basically have proof of work instead. And that's very bad. But it was eventually fixed by a hard fork, where they just changed the parameters that determine the block validity. And as far as I'm aware, no one actually exploited this fix, this bug. But an attacker could have generated a lot more blocks than he or she was supposed to. Another example of a protocol level bug is the 2016 Ethereum gas schedule denial of service attack. So some attacker found that certain operations in the Ethereum virtual machine were much cheaper than they were supposed to be. So there was this opcode called ext code size, I think, which caused a lot more disk fetches, or excessive amounts of data fetched from disk. And it was priced, like very mispriced, based on how much computational resources were required to actually execute this opcode. And this was eventually solved by changing the gas schedule in Ethereum. It was changed via hard forks, and hard forks are dangerous, so it was a problematic bug to fix. And the same types of bugs that the blockchain itself faces, smart contracts also face, or at least similar types of bugs. So smart contract programming is a very new field, and best practices are constantly evolving. And like smart contracts also manages value, just as like the core blockchain does. So security is really, really important. So the security mindset that we should have in like core blockchain development applies equally to smart contract programming. And one example of a smart contract attack that probably some of you are familiar with is the DAO attack. So there was a smart contract running on Ethereum that had what was called a re-entrancy vulnerability. It resulted in an attacker being able to make multiple withdrawals, multiple token withdrawals that exceeded his balance. So this was eventually reversed via hard fork. And it wasn't caused by any bug in any of the core Ethereum clients. But however, the DAO smart contract contained about 14% of all Ethereum at the time, so it stored a lot of value. And also, the hard fork that was made to solve this issue was contentious. Like, some people didn't agree ideologically with the hard fork because they thought that one of the basic concepts in Ethereum when it was launched was that a lot of people said that Ethereum is great because it will code is supposed to be law. You're not supposed to, like, the smart contract itself should specify exactly what should happen. If there's a bug in the smart contract, then that's part of the deal of the smart contract. And some people disagreed, some people didn't agree with it, and eventually this caused the formation of the Ethereum Classic when they performed a hard fork to reverse the problems of the DAO attack. Basically, it caused a network split. So in this case, some people just decided to not run the updated code that reversed the effects of the DAO attack. So Ethereum, after the DAO attack, released an updated version of Ethereum. And if everyone don't update to this new version of Ethereum, then it will cause a hard fork, like, because there are consensus issues and the network will split.
So after you run the new code,
yeah,
we'll take the money that was siphoned off and,
yeah,
put it back to where it was?
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah. Another more recent example of a smart contract vulnerability is the November 2017 Parity multisig wallet incident. And this was actually a GitHub issue comment that was posted on the Parity wallet issue tracker, where this guy just posted that he accidentally killed the contract at that address. And it was actually the contract that all Parity multisig wallets relied upon, which caused about $300 million in Ethereum tokens being inaccessible. He claimed he did it by accident, which is possible, but who knows. So he triggered a bug that allowed himself to be set as the owner of that Parity multisig contract, and afterwards he called a function that destructed the contract, deleting the contract, which made everyone who relied on that contract unable to access their funds. So actors that cause loss of funds, they don't necessarily need to have malicious intent. And a bug in a smart contract, basically it was one smart contract that other smart contracts relied upon, and a bug in that contract triggered like effects in all the other smart contracts that relied upon it. So one other problem with vulnerabilities in blockchains and smart contracts as well is that it's very hard to recover from failure. So usually, like, these are decentralized networks. There are like thousands of regular people running the software, and you have no way to actually force people to upgrade. And it usually takes a long time for everyone in the network, or like a super majority of the network, to upgrade. Another problem is that the bugs can be very severe, as many of these cases showed. Like, they can cause loss of funds of a lot of money for people. Another problem is transaction irreversibility, which I will go into further soon. And like the example of the DAO hard fork, or the DAO attack fix hard fork, you can potentially split the network when you try to upgrade the code. So vulnerabilities may require hard forks. So backwards incompatible changes may cause a consensus break. And if you have a consensus break, then the network may fork, and you may have two distinct networks that split from each other. Even if you give people enough time to upgrade so that everyone is running, or are supposed to be running, the same code, people may be ideologically opposed to running the new code. There may be like differing opinions. Like, an example of this is like Bitcoin and Bitcoin Cash, where people disagree on the parameters of the network, and that causes a hard fork. And another example, like, as I mentioned earlier, is the DAO hard fork that created Ethereum Classic. And attackers also have a very large financial incentive to actually try to perform attacks on these networks. Like, the market cap, okay, now maybe it's not 500 billion of all cryptocurrencies, now maybe it's about 300 billion, somewhere around there. 400, okay. But it's very high nonetheless. It's like a lot of value that's stored in these blockchains and smart contracts. And there are a lot of them also. Like, when I checked this in March sometime, there were 450 cryptocurrencies or tokens that have a market capitalization of at least $10 million. And attackers also have a relatively easy time of staying anonymous. Like, these networks are supposed to be kind of anonymous, so it's usually pretty easy for an attacker to also remain anonymous and not face any legal risk when performing attacks against cryptocurrencies and smart contracts. A problem when trying to fix the effects of potential attacks is the fact that transactions are irreversible. So after some period of time, or rather some period of some number of block confirmations, people start to regard transactions that have been included in the blockchain as being irreversible. And so, for example, if someone finds a way to, let's say, create Bitcoin or Qtum out of thin air and manages to get that transaction included in a block, and no one notices that for a while, then that person might transfer the proceeds from himself to buy stuff, or to deposit it at an exchange and exchange it for altcoins or whatever. And if you then try to reverse that transaction, you will cause loss of funds to honest users that just accepted these funds, believing that there was no maliciousness involved. And so again, it's hard to recover from failure because you can actually cause loss of funds from honest users. And a lot of the time when these types of attacks were found out, the attacker was simply allowed to keep the proceeds. The attacker was simply allowed to keep the funds or tokens that the attacker was able to either steal or create out of thin air, because it was simply impossible to do a rollback, or it was too harmful to the network. So therefore, it's very important to do proper testing and review before deploying blockchain code. And it's equally important for smart contracts, because they usually hold a lot of value as well. And as we can see from the previous slides, like the Bitcoin team, the Ethereum team, the Parity team as well, like, these are highly competent people, but they can also make mistakes. And it's important to be able to mitigate any bugs that are discovered, any bugs or vulnerabilities. So let's go a little bit into Qtum's approach to security and testing. So we try to always use code that has been proven, that has proven itself stable. So we use the Ethereum code, the Bitcoin code, we use Blackcoin's code, because those projects have existed for a long time, and they've existed in adversarial environments, and they've had few or no bugs in quite a while, at least nothing critical. And also, it simplifies for us because we avoid like reinventing the wheel. We avoid like writing our own primitives for everything. We avoid writing code for a lot of the network handling or for the database handling. And that allows us to focus on Qtum and the innovations of Qtum instead. And it also allows us to test these innovations very thoroughly and review them. So one of the projects that Qtum builds upon is Bitcoin, of course. And the reason for it is that Bitcoin is probably the most mature project in this space. It has existed for many years, and there have been very few vulnerabilities associated with Bitcoin the last few years. And it forms the main basis for Qtum's code base. It basically all the networking, all the database handling, a lot of the cryptographic primitives are derived from Bitcoin. And the testing infrastructure, which is important to me as a tester, is also derived from Bitcoin. Another project that we build upon is, or derive a lot of our Ethereum virtual machine from, is CPP Ethereum, which is an implementation of Ethereum that is very modular, and it's also very mature. So it's likely highly secure. And the third project that we derive our proof of stake from is Blackcoin. And Blackcoin is maybe a lesser known project than Ethereum or Bitcoin, but it has been in existence with a working proof of stake model for a long time. Their proof of stake model is called POS version 3. And it's a pure proof of stake model, and it has been modified in Qtum to the mutualized proof of stake model that Wenbin described earlier. So Qtum's approach to security and testing is basically that we want to reuse as much code as possible that we deem to be secure. So we can focus instead on stuff like the account abstraction layer, the decentralized governance protocol, our mutualized proof of stake, and the thing that we're focusing most on right now, the x86 virtual machine. And we can focus very much on testing these new features. So this is the basic testing flow in Qtum. So it starts off with some new code. We perform unit tests that test basically the functions itself. Then we perform integration and functional testing, which are like bigger tests that test, for example, the RPC interface, interaction with other nodes. And then someone will create a pull request to the main repository, and other developers or reviewers will perform code review. And the reviewers will also perform manual testing. Then that pull request may be merged, and we may create a new release. And before, when we have created a new release, we have a period of acceptance testing, where everyone on the team tests the new software, sees that there's no bugs in like the graphical user interface, that there are no obvious bugs with the RPC interface, etc. It's just an extra period of testing that many of the team members participate in. And if there's like really big features that we are going to deploy, then we'll create a new testnet for those new features. So, for example, for the x86 VM, we will likely have several iterations of testnets before it will become active on the mainnet. And if all of these steps pass, then we will deploy the code to mainnet. And after we've deployed code to mainnet, we do continuous monitoring, so we check that everything looks good in the blockchain, basically. That there are no weird transactions that shouldn't be allowed, people aren't allowed to generate blocks at a faster rate than they're supposed to, etc. So we have two primary automated testing suites in Qtum. They're both inherited from Bitcoin. One is a C++ testing suit, and the other is a Python testing suit. And the unit tests in Qtum are written in C++. And they should basically make sure that given a certain input to a function, it should reply with an expected output. And this is typically done by the developer of the new code. It may be that certain unit tests are added by other developers as well. And then we have integration and functional tests. And these are like bigger tests that test the complete functionality of Qtum. And they're primarily done via the RPC interface. It was the RPC interface that Howard was showing you previously. So it's basically the same as the command line interface, or it's identical to the command line interface. And this may be done either by a developer or a tester. And all RPC calls or command line calls should have some functional tests associated with them, so we have proper test coverage. And the code review is typically done by other developers. These developers check that the code follows the proper coding standard, checks that the intent of the code is clear, and they also try to do like analysis of the code to see that there are no hidden bugs that they themselves can spot. And then usually manual or always manual testing is performed, and this is done by either developers or testers. And this should verify that everything works as expected on the regression testing mode in Qtum. They should also check that the chain syncs to mainnet with all the changes included, and that it's backwards compatible. So if it doesn't sync to mainnet, then it's likely not backward compatible, and someone has somehow introduced a hard fork in through the code, which would be very bad. And then we have, as I said earlier, acceptance testing, which is done by all members of the team, and make sure that the graphical user interface is functional, make sure that the RPC interface is functional. And then deployment to testnet, potentially. And this is basically done to enable long-term testing, so that if there are, there may in some cases be bugs that aren't triggered immediately. There may be, for example, race conditions that are very hard to detect. But if you allow the code to run for a long time, you're significantly more likely to actually trigger these types of issues. And as I said earlier, this is typically done for larger changes to the code base. And then we do continuous monitoring. Basically, we check that everything looks fine in what would be the equivalent of a block explorer. We check that all transactions look fine, that there are no weird blocks or weird transactions in the blocks. So Qtum can be run in a few different modes. And these different modes modify different parameters of the blockchain. So the parameters that may be changed are, for example, block times, when the proof of stake consensus model activates, block rewards, and many, many other things. And these modes are the same modes that Howard mentioned earlier. There are mainnet, testnet, and regtest. There is also a separate mode, which isn't really super important, which is unit regtest, which is the mode that is used in the C++ unit test framework. Running basically, all these modes are so that you can run Qtum in different types of test modes. So all non-mainnet modes use basically play tokens. So you can spend coins as much as you like without actually risking losing any value. And again, all these different modes are inherited, but to some extent modified from Bitcoin. So the regression testing mode allows you to generate blocks on demand. So you can generate blocks almost instantly. And you can generate both proof of stake blocks as well as proof of work blocks. And it makes it easy to build like your own private blockchain instance, which you can perform further testing on. And the second mode is the testnet mode. Which is very similar to the mainnet, but tokens have no value in the testnet. And again, this is used for final testing before deploying to mainnet. And this should be used for final testing also if you're developing smart contracts. Then you would like to first deploy the smart contract to the testnet so you can see that it actually works under real network conditions properly, before deploying it to the mainnet. And again, there may exist multiple test networks at a time for testing different types of features. So this is just a screenshot from our block explorer for the, this must be, yeah, this is the testnet. So one thing you can see, like this is a screenshot from the testnet, and this is the difficulty, which shows how hard it is to mine new blocks. And if you see the same value on the mainnet screenshot, you can see it's much easier to actually generate or mine blocks on the testnet than it is on the mainnet. So that is one feature that is easier to actually test for when you're on the test network instead of the main network. Then finally, we have the mainnet, which is the real network where tokens and coins have actual value. And all code that is deployed to the mainnet should have been thoroughly tested and reviewed. These are just simple examples of how you actually run the different modes. So the first example runs the Qtum executable in regtest mode, and it disables staking, so you can only generate blocks via the generate RPC call. So you can only generate proof of work blocks and not proof of stake blocks, or it will not generate proof of stake blocks automatically in this mode. And the second one is for the testnet mode, it says itself. And then the third one is like the regular mainnet mode. So, as I said earlier, there are different types of test suits in Qtum. There is a C++ test suit and a Python test suit. And both originate from Bitcoin and are quite similar to Bitcoin's version of these test suits, but they've been modified to enable testing of Qtum-specific features. So they've been modified so you can test proof of stake, so you can test smart contracts, and the DGP. And they'll eventually be changed also to include functionality for testing the x86 virtual machine. So the C++ test suit is primarily for unit tests, and it's useful for testing functions in isolation. And if you have a copy of the Qtum, if you've checked out Qtum from GitHub, you can find all those tests under src/test, and you'll find a bunch of different C++ tests. And you can run the test suit by running make check from the root folder of Qtum. And the other main test suit that exists in Qtum is the Python test suit. And this is useful for testing much more complex scenarios. And this test suit may enable you to test like much more complex scenarios where nodes can interact with each other. You can test sending weird data over the network interface. You can try out weird sequences of calling RPC commands with the data that they're not supposed to receive, and see that you can't trigger any sort of bug or vulnerability by doing that. And you can find the test suits or test files under qa/rpc-tests, and you'll find a bunch of files. And all the Qtum specific files in that directory are prefixed with Qtum. And yeah, there are a bunch of them. And you can run the test suit by calling qa/pull-tester, yeah, that command at the bottom. And so this is an example of a contract creation test case in Qtum. It's written in Python, so it's for the Python test suit. And actually, like these types of test cases is a great way to actually start developing start to develop core software for blockchains, because like, first of all, you don't really touch any of the core parts, so you can't like cause a hard fork when you submit your pull request. You can't really introduce any security vulnerabilities. And you learn a lot about how the core software actually works when you're writing these sorts of test cases. So if you want to start with the core development, I would really recommend to get into like testing and writing test cases. It's a great way to learn a lot more. And yeah, but even though we have a lot of testing, there is still a risk that bugs can appear and vulnerabilities can appear. And there we have our decentralized governance protocol. So to repeat what others have said already, the DGP is a smart contract which allows configuration changes of a certain set of parameters. So it allows you to update, for example, the block weight, gas limits, and also the gas schedule. And this allows us to mitigate the effects of certain vulnerabilities. If a vulnerability was to slip through all our testing procedures, then we can use the DGP to potentially fix the issue or at least mitigate the effects of the issue. So, for example, the 2016 Ethereum denial of service attack would have been possible to fix on Qtum without a hard fork, because we could simply use the DGP to update the gas schedule and fix the mispriced operations in Ethereum's virtual machine, and we would not cause a potential network split. But we also want to be conservative when it comes to the DGP, so it's not supposed to be like something that can change the fundamental processes of the blockchain itself. So there are, at the moment, like not that many parameters that can be changed via the DGP, because we don't want a compromised DGP to allow an attacker to, for example, steal funds or cause basically loss of funds to users, because those problems would be really, really bad. However, the most an attacker should be able to do with a compromised DGP should be to make the network unusable, basically. An attacker should only be able to basically cause a denial of service attack against the network, and that could be fixed via a hard fork if that were to happen, but it's highly unlikely. Okay, that's it. Thank you very much for listening. Do you have any questions? Yeah. So at the moment, the DGP is the keys that control the DGP are controlled by the Qtum itself. But like our plan is that it's supposed to have, like in our white paper, we describe several different methods for having governance for the DGP. So we want to allow the community to be a part of the governance of the DGP. We also had proposals for like doing AI smart contracts for controlling the DGP, so it can basically self-upgrade depending on the health of the network. But those parts of the DGP are not active in the mainnet at the moment. But yeah, but like the security issues are basically the same. I mean, like the problems of security are very similar. So, I mean, one thing I would say that is specific for smart contracts is that like the tooling surrounding smart contracts is very immature at the moment. So you have like Solidity, which is an attempt to create a proper smart contracting language, but there is not that much tooling that helps you actually debug smart contracts, and like it's such a new field that it's hard to write smart contracts securely, and that's one of the things that we're trying to fix by introducing our x86 VM, so we can allow people to write smart contracts in languages that they already know, where there already exists like proper tool chains, where there exists proper debuggers and stuff like that. Yeah?
So does Qtum, right, after you deploy the mainnet, right, do you have a great team or something to continually try to attack your phone systems to see whether the security will compromise, or do you just need after the public to
yourself? How do you mean? Like if we try to...
Okay, so what, for security people, right? Well, yeah. Let's say I have my own server and stuff, right?
Yeah.
Some people test their own systems by having a group of hackers, right?
Yeah.
To try and attack their own system.
Mm-hmm.
So that if there's any vulnerability, any exploit, right, they will report to me.
Yeah, yeah. We have a big bug bounty, I think, for any bugs that are submitted to us by like the community. So we of course like encourage people to submit any bugs that they found. But so far, I don't think we've had actually any bugs found by community members, and we've been having that bug bounty in existence for a long time now. Yeah, but we've had some bug reports on like forum, like the forum software and stuff like that, but nothing like the core client or any of the core parts. Yes.
So you don't have a bug bounty program in place, or do you?
Yeah, we have a bounty program.
I think it's via
HackerOne.
HackerOne. So you are there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we use Bitcoin's network stack. So like that was part of the things that like we try to reuse code that's already proven to work. Like Bitcoin's networking stack is like proven to work already, so we reuse Bitcoin's networking stack.
So you don't do layer five.
Yeah. Yeah, that should be right. Yeah. Yeah. I think it's both. I mean, I think the main issue is that it's just hard to write like software without bugs. But like Solidity probably doesn't help. Like there are some stuff in Solidity where at least I think like you could have chosen like sensible defaults that prevent people from accidentally introducing vulnerabilities. Like for example, if you like all functions in Solidity have access modifiers, and the default access modifier, if I'm not remembering incorrectly, is that everything is public, and that's not a sensible default, at least according to me. Like you would want everything to be private by default. But like, yeah, the problem I would say is that like it's hard to write correct code. That's the main issue. But like you can of course improve like the tooling and the languages that you are using.
But is there a proper documentation for
Solidity?
Yeah.
There is. I mean, there is documentation at least.
I went to the Ethereum website.
Yeah.
You just dive in there without proper explanation. So
actually, the last time I checked, I've had some. Now that you're mentioning, yeah, I think there is maybe some lack in or gaps at least in the documentation. But I think maybe Howard, you have.
Or you can use somebody else's
like what consent
to take somebody's. run it securely.
Yeah.
And then provision future.
Yeah, I mean, that might be possible. I'm not really sure. I think you should probably pose that question to Earls, which is our co-founder and the lead developer, especially on the x86 stuff. He could probably give you a good answer to that question. Yes?
David, when you implement a change to the network, do you need to coordinate for the simultaneous upgrade of the software by the minimum number of nodes to achieve consensus?
Do you mean like to not cause a hard fork? You need a minimum number of nodes to not cause like hard forks. Is that your question?
No. Let's say you want to do an upgrade. There's a change you want to implement, right?
Yeah.
When you roll it out, do you need to coordinate with, say, minimum number of nodes in order for the new software to achieve consensus?
Yeah.
Or
I mean,
just leave it organically, one by one, as and when they pick it up, then they can just.
That depends on the upgrade. Like if it's an upgrade that would cause a hard fork, then you need like basically a super majority of the nodes actually running it. But like in practice, you'll always cause, if you upgrade code so that you would cause a hard fork, a certain number of the nodes won't upgrade. So you'll always cause like a small network split. But it's if like the network split becomes big, like in the case of, for example, Ethereum Classic, it's then that it really becomes a problem. Like if the network split creates two networks where both networks, like the tokens that are on both networks are considered to have value. That's like, a core problem. Yeah. I shouldn't say that. I'm gonna pause on that question because if I add, I shouldn't be saying that like publicly. Like you should disclose that to the Bitcoin core team. Like if any on our team had found anything that was, Okay. Thank you, guys.